something I'm doing on Monday in Brussels, which is talking to European trade unions about what to do about this crisis. This very, very big financial crisis. For example, let's see something. For example, the European Union is nominally committed to... Oh, I apologize for speaking in English. I might find my English. Some of this is a bit technical. The people I'm talking to are the economists. And although normally I am an economist, I'm not clever enough to understand. Although nominally an economist, they're still a politician. But one or two of them might be significant. There's nominally this European recovery. Who's heard of the European economic recovery? Hands up. Gosh, I'm really impressed. I mean, that must be about six of you. Who's heard of European debt crisis? That's a bit more like what I'd expect. Who knows what the European debt crisis is? That's interesting. How much debt does Europe have? Trillions. Who owns this European debt? Who's got it? Who's got it in their pocket? Now, let's make it easy. TEDx is about making things simple. Who holds Portugal's debt? You do. Well, I hope you've got a credit default swap on it. You have insured it, have you? Yeah. Who's going to buy the insurance? You see, I meant it when I said I'm an economist, by the way. I didn't say I'm a communist. Just after the revolution in Cuba, Fidel got the commandantes together and he said, right, here's an economist. Che Guevara said, I'm an economist. He thought Fidel had asked, who's a communist? Well, I'm not a communist. I very nearly didn't become an economist. I attended a course in Midwestern America at one time, and I found that they're all talking a private language game. They're all talking about equilibrium this, approximation to that, running calculus, all changes linear, incremental, smooth, but all changes from one equilibrium to another. There's some very clever economists who keep getting Nobel Prizes. They're telling us what we already know. Putting us in very words. Or others who told us that financial markets are rational. Financial markets can be predicted with mathematical certainty. Markets always clear. disturbance, there will be a return to equilibrium. But it didn't work out. In 2007, there was a financial collapse by hedge funds and banks. We believe it was theory. For them, nothing really went wrong, because when their collapse threatened the collapse of the whole Western financial system, they said to governments, you've got to bail us out. You've got to pay. That's why Portugal now is in such a mess. That's why the whole of Southern Europe is in a mess. That's why Europe itself is in a mess. Real threatened disintegration. Well, let's get back to the simple first questions. European Bank, European Central Bank, in May started to buy up national debt, which is down to the tune of about 60 billion, or half of 1% of European GDP. The way out of this, the way to cut the Gordian knot is twin. One is a tranche transfer. Of national debt to Europe. Because the reason that none of you can answer the question, how big is Europe's debt, is that until May this year, it had none. None. Zero. Zilch. It didn't have any. There's only national debt. I propose, when I left the pub to help Jacques Delors try and shape the instruments for what was called economic and social cohesion. Now, these words were never said to me. They're French, cohesion et économique sociale. And they mean high levels of employment. Even full employment, welfare, expenditure on health, education, urban renewal, the urban environment. Everything that at the moment we are told we cannot have. It's cuts, cuts, cancellation. It's a kind of Euro-masochism. The European Central Bank started to buy up national debt. It isn't working. For example, Portuguese, the rate of interest in Portugal paying national debt is double that of the European Union. And in Greece, it's 3-4 times. I propose